It could be said that life begins with RNA, self-replicating molecules that can store information. That ability is necessary for life, and it's hard to imagine how life could exist without that kind of storage medium to start out. After all, how is nature to build an organism without a set of instructions? It doesn't seem very plausible that it could, though there have been very exotic possible life forms advanced in the past entirely independent of DNA. But those suggestions usually come with some serious baggage, such as hypothesized life on the surface of a neutron star, or even the atmosphere of a sun-like star. They are very much stretches in that we have no indication of their existence, and they really are just thought experiments that even if they did exist, we would have no way of verifying it. Do not get close to a neutron star to check it for exotic life. And yes, I know since I mentioned neutron star life, I need to make an aside and explain the concept. It traces back to a suggestion by the late Frank Drake, and later expanded upon in the novels of Robert Forward, that a neutron star is really just a star in name only, or once was one. But in actuality, it's really more like a planet, physically speaking, albeit with an enormous gravitational field. Under the pressures of the surface of a neutron star, matter becomes degenerate, and Drake pointed out that individual atomic nuclei could bound together as a kind of nuclear molecule. What the limits on that are unknown, but he speculated that maybe some kind of life based on that might be possible. That's a stretch, we really don't know much of anything about that, but one thing is clear, if such life were possible, it would run in fast forward, due to nuclear reactions happening much faster than chemical ones, meaning that such life could have a life cycle around a million times quicker than our own. The other concept of star life is that certain types of plasmas display lifelike behavior, but that's an even further stretch, based more on what we see as the criteria for calling something alive than an actual life form. That said, while there are alternative thoughts on how life could arise, RNA and DNA-based life remains a very solid bet, one that we self-prove that it can happen in nature. There's no reason to suspect that such chemistry doesn't happen all over the universe. As a result, looking for genomes in the search for alien life will be an important step should we find microbial life on Mars or Venus, or whatever lies beneath the shells of ice at Enceladus and Europa and elsewhere. Genetics will literally tell us if we have truly found simple alien life, or if we have found a panspermic cousin. Interestingly, that doesn't hold true for a technological advanced alien species that can alter its genetics. That for another video. If we do ever find another instance of independent genetics, however, it's a very good bet that it will share one common attribute. It's likely to have genetics just as messy as our own, filled with the flotsam of billions of years of evolution, leading to huge amounts of junk DNA. While our genetics clearly work, they are an absolute mess, with DNA that either serves no function at all, or goes horribly wrong, opening us up for genetic diseases. A fully natural alien species, microbial to macrofauna, is likely to have very messy genetics, simply because that's how the process works in nature. But that's where this gets spooky. What if you find genetics that aren't messy? The first point to hit on here is known as the minimal genome. This is the question of the simplest genome you need to support something that can be defined as life, which is very likely going to depend on whatever environment the organism in question lives in. But it can be said that it's the bare minimum an organism needs to get by. This is important in unlocking a biogenesis, because the first life was probably minimal and simple, though probably still messy. But in studying the idea of a minimal genome, it often removes genes that aren't just useless, but those that are minimal or situational. It's just an attempt to gain insight on what the bare minimum actually is. That incidentally would also allow you to hit the minimum and then start custom creating an organism by adding in desirable genes. Here we actually have an example in nature. There are organisms that have very small genome sizes. And for one in particular, it's proposed that the minimum it can get by with is just 256 genes. And indeed, work has been done to create an artificial cell that functions on just 473 genes. The point here is that it has proven possible to slim down genomes to the bare minimum needed for survival, and then expand upon that to create a customized, streamlined organism. And this scales up, though we are a long way from being able to do so with such a complex genome as a human or even a reptile. But it is in principle possible to create streamlined, customized genomes. And this is where it gets creepy. It would, in a sense, represent perfection. The perfect organism. Something explored both in the Alien franchise and Star Trek Voyager. The cleared genome. That perhaps a computer might look at and find perfection. Something resembling perfect mathematics and calculation. It might even model it beforehand, create it, and then send it out as a panspermic organism, specially constructed specifically for the dissemination of this kind of life throughout the galaxy. This could create a situation of a shadow biosphere, where a natural genesis of life has occurred on a habitable world, but that a panspermic sleeper might also exist. This is a possibility. It's very difficult to detect microbial life, and many of the methods scientists use would not detect a shadow biosphere, rather are dependent on what we know of our brand of life. But with something of a different origin, it's a bit harder, leading to the shadow biosphere hypothesis. But here the shadow biosphere is not a second genesis of life on Earth, but a seeded one we are simply unlikely to discover with our usual methods. This opens up the option that the seeded biosphere may have an eventual purpose, some point where it lies hidden until it becomes time for it to accomplish its mission, and then it no longer hides, altering or interacting with the open biosphere it was sent to infect or change. This could also apply to nanotechnological replicator machines, functioning as machine life. We may simply not be looking for them, but could in principle be present and ready to self-replicate and accomplish a mission in the future based on a currently undetectable population here on Earth. In this is that the solution to the Fermi paradox in this case is a scenario where some progenitor civilization hit upon machine civilization and either became that or was terminated by their own invention, or even uplifted by it to be something else entirely, perhaps a fusion of machine civilization and biological existence. This could imply that the Great Silence is artificial, and that such a machine civilization in its search for perfection simply downshifts any biology it comes across to be simple and perfect. But you could also spin another scenario, a genome planted as a SETI signal. The panspermic or planted organism again lays low until something triggers it, perhaps the appearance of an artificial chemical that doesn't exist in nature, triggering it to self-replicate on a larger level, enough to become detectable and thus provide us with a perfect genome for which we have no analog of on Earth, other than our own experiments, as a method of saying hello. It would be an unnatural, streamlined genetic code in an organism that we didn't create, leading us to ask the question of who did, since it's unlikely to be messy in nature and evolution itself, so it must be from somewhere else. Such a thing might even include DNA sequences unknown in anything else on this world. Perhaps a kind of confirmation of having originally been of alien origin. You could in a way see this as a kind of biological artifact, a living thing that makes no other sense than it being artificial and of alien origin. An alien shadow biosphere on Earth that we discover using methods more related to investigating a crime scene than pointing a radio telescope. But that still requires the crossing of vast amounts of space to get such a sample here. But there may be another way. Much thought has been put into the idea of detecting radio signals of alien origin, but not as much thought has been dedicated to what information such a signal might contain. This is because the general assumption is that it's unlikely that we could ever decode an alien signal, unless it was something obvious like prime numbers counting down. But there are ways to represent scientific information in a radio signal that might be decodable, such as the radio representation of the behavior of hydrogen that's been suggested as a possible decoding of what little we saw of the WOW signal, and its associated stepped-up numbers and frequency. A self-confirming SETI signal, link to my video on that in the description below. That said, it may be possible to send a representation of a genetic code with a long enough duration radio signal. It's a huge amount of information to send, but it may be a natural one, if all intelligent species in the universe likely to contact each other all work on genetics. It may be a viable way. Shared is good, because that makes it recognizable, hopefully. But what would you do with a genome sent from an alien species? What could you know about whatever it is that you might recreate on your own world? Is it the alien version of a pet that they've sent you? The cutest thing in the universe, in their opinion, like the galactic version of a cat or dog video? Or is it the alien species themselves? So you can get a scientific look at what actual complex alien life actually looks like. Or is it a velociraptor-level xenomorph monster designed to conquer your planet and prepared for occupation? There have been suggestions within astrobiology that the first SETI message we ever received could be something similar to a computer virus. That's unlikely. It would be beyond difficult for an alien civilization to send us something that could infect our computers. The word biological virus doesn't really fit either, though. We have those. So this might be best termed as a civilization virus, where damaging genetic information is sent with malicious intent. Or maybe it's back to square one, and whatever genome the aliens send is what they view as perfection. And what would motivate their search for perfection would remain unknown. We would simply see it as a very unnaturally clean genome. And admittedly, this is an unlikely scenario, and we do not currently possess the technology to recreate an alien organism from its genome information from scratch, but in the relatively distant future, we may. And the question becomes that if we receive a genome from an unknown alien source one way or another, perhaps preserved in an interstellar artifact, do we recreate it and print it out, so to speak? Or do we be cautious and never try it? What happens if we do? Thanks for listening. I am science fiction author and futurist John Michael, he ain't no David Attenborough, Godier, currently miffed at the natural world again. It's fall and cooling down here in the Northern Hemisphere, and as a result, it's an apocalyptic landscape of garden death for annual plants, or those effectively so. The lettuce is a memory, the tomatoes are mummies, the peppers are zombies, and then there is the kale. It's fine. As in vampire fine. Very suspect plant indeed, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.